In this lesson, you're going to understand the concepts of OLAP, MDX, and business intelligence. But before we move on to OLAP, let's look at some of the problems that OLAP was invented to solve. Dr. E.F. Codd, an IBM scientist, invented the relational database in the early 70s. In 1979, Oracle released their first commercial relational database product. By the mid to late 1990s, relational databases had come of age. Almost all big corporations used a relational database to store their data. But with the adoption of relational databases came a problem. Companies found that relational databases were great at storing data, but made it difficult to generate management reports from transactional data. If, for example, you needed to report sales for a specific month, the database server would potentially have to loop through millions of transactions in order to generate a total. On the hardware of the day, this would often slow down the entire system to the point where it became unusable for critical business operations. Of course, the reports would still be generated eventually, but the whole process took far too long. So Dr. Codd looked at the problem once again and came up with the solution: OLAP. The idea behind OLAP was to pre-compute all of the totals and subtotals needed for reporting at night or at the weekend when the database server was normally idle. The totals are stored in a special database called an OLAP cube. An OLAP cube doesn't have to loop through any transactions because totals are all pre-calculated, providing instant access. An OLAP cube is a snapshot of data at a specific point in time, perhaps at the end of a specific day, week, month, or year. The standard version of Excel 2013 now provides a complete OLAP solution on your desktop. In Lesson 6.2, you actually created an OLAP cube without realizing it. When you create an OLAP pivot table from a data model, an OLAP cube is automatically created in the computer's memory and is used to power an OLAP pivot table. At any time, you can refresh the cube using the current values in the source tables. With very large data sets, it could take an appreciable amount of time for Excel to reconstruct the cube. But with the data sets we've been using, just a couple of thousand rows, the process appears to be instantaneous. Now let's move on to business intelligence, or BI. When IT professionals talk about business intelligence, they usually mean the analysis and presentation of data stored in an OLAP cube. In the recent past, it was very expensive to implement a business intelligence solution. BI projects would often take many months to complete and involve large numbers of highly trained IT professionals to design and extract data into the OLAP cubes. The vision for the Excel data model is that ordinary Excel users can create a ready-to-go OLAP cube almost instantly. Microsoft sometimes call this concept self-service BI. And unlike traditional business intelligence solutions, it can be implemented by ordinary Excel users and provides instant results because the OLAP cube is generated automatically. Now that you understand the concept behind OLAP, let's look at how an OLAP cube works in more detail. You know that you can create an OLAP cube from an Excel data model. Conceptually, you can think of an OLAP cube as consisting of many boxes, each with a total inside it. Now let's cover some OLAP terminology. It's important you understand this terminology because you'll find it used in some of the OLAP functions that will be used later in this session. And you'll also find it used in Microsoft's help pages. So first, let's talk about dimensions. I'm going to add a dimension to this OLAP cube, and that is the category dimension. You can see that this data would originate in the category table. And you can see that the front slice of the cube is coming from rolled up totals in the confections category. The centre slice is coming from rolled up totals in condiments category. And the rear slice is coming from rolled up totals in the beverages category. Now let's look at another dimension, this time the dimension of time. We're going to have January rolled up totals in the top slice of the cube, February rolled up totals in the next slice, then March, and then April rolled up totals in the bottom slice of the cube. And now let's cover another piece of OLAP technology, the measure. A measure is simply the thing that's been totaled. So let's add some measures along the bottom of the cube. In stock, on order, sales amount, sales cost, and sales quantity. Let's now put a value into one of those little boxes and see how we'd retrieve it. When you retrieve a value from an OLAP cube, the value is said to be at a cube intersection, that is, an intersection of a measure and dimensions. I can see that the measure this time is the sales amount, so the 2,233 is the total amount of sales at some point. Then I can see that this is in the January slice, so I know that 2,233 involves sales rolled up in January. And then I can see it's in the confections dimension. So I know this is sales for confections in January, and it's a sales amount. So 2,233 is the total sales amount in January in the confections category. Now let me talk about another piece of OLAP terminology, the concept of hierarchies. A good example of a hierarchy is months, quarters, and years. Items in a hierarchy have a parent-child relationship, and hierarchies come into play when you drill down into data. To make a bit more sense of what I've just said, let's add an example by adding a rolled-up total for 2013. You might begin by looking at sales for 2013, but then need to drill down into sales for March 2013. In this respect, 2013 is a parent in the hierarchy, and the months are children within the hierarchy. You can, of course, always compute the total parent sales by adding the sales of all the children together. Let's now add some more values to the front slice of this OLAP cube. And you can see that I can now see, in the confections category, my rolled up totals for January, February, March and April, in the five measures, in stock, on order, sales amount, sales cost and sales quantity. And in order to retrieve any of those values, I'd have to provide two dimensions and one measure. Now that you understand how OLAP cubes work, let's look at how Excel retrieves values from an OLAP cube into an OLAP pivot table. Here we have an OLAP cube that's been created from a relational data source. When the OLAP pivot table wants to get information from the OLAP cube, it uses a language called MDX, or multi-dimensional expressions. The OLAP pivot table creates an MDX query, and the cube sends back the data requested by the MDX query. Now you'll be pleased to know that you don't need to learn the MDX query language in order to use an OLAP pivot table. The queries are created behind the scenes automatically for you. Although it is possible to also roll your own if you do know the MDX query language. You're going to see some MDX expressions later in Lesson 6.6. MDX is an open standard that's also used by many non-Microsoft products, such as Cognos PowerPlay. An OLAP pivot table can, in theory, be used to report from any MDX-compliant OLAP source. Well, now that you understand the concepts of OLAP, MDX and business intelligence, you're ready to move on with the rest of this session. And you've now completed Lesson 6.3, Understand OLAP, MDX and Business Intelligence.